Radio HJKU en Bogotá en los 1430 AM y en Colombia y el mundo a través de unminutoradio.com.co. También en Facebook, Twitter e Instagram a través de arroba unminutoradio. La radio universitaria está aquí. Uniminuto Radio presenta El Puente.
Hola, ¿qué tal? Bienvenidos al Puente, un escenario donde se integran diversas voces.
Un espacio de diálogo, creatividad y encuentro.
Bueno, pues así es, bienvenidos al Puente, qué alegría estar una vez más con ustedes en este espacio que se transmite, bueno, de lunes a viernes a través de los 1430 AM, pero también a través de los diferentes canales de Marfil Educación Filosófica, a través de la Facultad de Ciencias Humanas y Sociales, a través del Departamento de Filosofía, a través de uniminutoradio.edu.co, diferentes canales que nos permiten llegar a ustedes, comunicarnos y además permitirnos también reflexionar sobre enfoques relacionados con la educación filosófica, con filosofía para niños. Cada día de la semana hemos estado aquí compartiendo un tema y hoy es un día especial para hablar de filosofía para niños. Y por eso, pues, hoy nos hemos ido un poco más allá. Hemos salido de estas fronteras de habla hispana y queremos ahora hacer una entrevista especial con una persona que tiene una trayectoria muy importante en el tema de filosofía para niños y en especial en el tema de la investigación que se hace en filosofía para niños. Y estoy hablando de Mon Gregory. Es una persona que además ha sido sucesor de Matthew Lidman en el Instituto para el Avance de Filosofía para Niños, en el IAPC. Es un centro en el cual en la Universidad de Montclair se ha venido impulsando y desarrollando toda esta propuesta de filosofía para niños. Además, Mon Gregory hace parte del IPIC, que es un organismo internacional que anima, facilita, divulga todo el tema de la filosofía para niños en el mundo. En este momento, Mon Gregory hace parte de este consejo, de este equipo de personas, con un cargo en particular relacionado con la investigación. Él está como coordinador del área de investigaciones del IPIC. Recordemos que hace algunos años estuvimos con la sede del Congreso Mundial llamado IPIC, justamente en el 2019 estuvimos en Colombia haciendo este trabajo, haciendo este evento importante. Y pues ahora estaremos con Mon Gregory y además nos contará sobre las nuevas versiones del IPIC que ya se avecina además para el próximo año. Así que sean ustedes bienvenidos a este espacio. Esto es El Puente y le doy una cordial bienvenida a Mon Gregory. Mon Gregory, bienvenido a Colombia a través de esta virtualidad. Bienvenido a este programa El Puente.
Gracias, Víctor. I'm happy to be here.
¿Cómo es que Mon Gregory llega a la propuesta de filosofía para niños? Hablemos de eso, de cómo es que es el acercamiento de Mon a Matthew Lidman y a la propuesta de filosofía para niños.
Well, I first discovered philosophy for children in Hawaii, where I got my master's degree at the University of Hawaii, and Tom Jackson there still runs the philosophy for children program, and so I took a class with him, and he put me immediately into the schools. I started working with the children.
Claro que sí. Además, a Tom Jackson lo hemos leído los trabajos de Tom Jackson, especialmente lo que él ha hecho en relación a las herramientas de diálogo. Hemos leído algunos trabajos de Tom. Bueno, ¿y qué fue lo que vio en particular, además, en filosofía para niños, Mon Gregory? ¿Qué vio de filosofía para niños que le llamó la atención y que además hoy todavía lo tiene trabajando en la propuesta de Matthew Lidman?
Well, my mother was a school teacher, and she was also a philosopher in her own right. She didn't study philosophy, but she was very philosophical minded. And so I had many deep philosophical conversations with her growing up, and many of them were about education. We would talk about what she was doing in the classroom and why. So when I began to study philosophy, it was actually my mother who found an article by Matthew Lidman, and she sent it to me, and I became interested in that. So when I was, as I say, when I was doing my master's degree, I just took the class to see if it was something I was interested in, and I immediately fell in love with it. I immediately recognized that this was one of the most valuable applications of philosophy I had ever seen. And in doing the philosophy with children myself, I immediately recognized that children are philosophical already. And so that was a very precious experience for me.
Bueno, pues esa afirmación que usted acaba de hacer, Mon, de los niños como filósofos, es bastante discutida, hay posiciones críticas frente a ellas. Sin embargo, sabemos que Matthew Lidman, con Gary Matthew y tantas personas, afinaron un poco el concepto, seguramente tuvieron en cuenta la tradición filosófica, y afinaron el concepto de el niño es un filósofo. ¿Podría desarrollar un poco más esta idea de por qué los niños son filósofos?
Yeah, I think there are two important different ways of thinking of children as philosophers. I've just finished a book with Megan Laverty on the late American philosopher Gareth Matthews. And the way he did philosophy with young children beginning in the early 1970s was to use storybooks, children's books. And Matthews believed that children are already philosophers. They already have the same philosophical questions that adult philosophers have. And if you give them the opportunity to just talk about these questions, the children will start doing philosophy on their own. And there's nothing you have to do to help them do it. They're already doing it. And I believe that. I've experienced that myself. Matthew Lipman had a little bit different approach. Matthew Lipman thought that children were potentially philosophers. So Matthew Lipman had a kind of a different idea. He believed that children were potentially philosophers. He believed that they were capable of doing philosophy, but they needed to be shown how. They needed a method. They needed to learn a particular method that would help them to become philosophical. And so the novels that he wrote were to help them do that. And the idea of the community of inquiry protocol that he developed with Anne Margaret Sharp was meant to help children teach them how to do philosophy.
Muy bien, usted de hecho menciona el carácter metodológico desarrollado por Matthew Lidman y Margaret Sharp, y que tiene mucho que ver tanto con un currículo especial de novelas y materiales, como con un ambiente llamado la comunidad de diálogo. Quisiera que habláramos un poco de esos dos aspectos. En primer lugar, de la comunidad de diálogo. ¿Cómo la comunidad de diálogo se convierte en ese ambiente que favorece el filosofar y que además es un ambiente de investigación filosófica? De hecho, algunos lo traducen como comunidad de investigación. Hablemos un poco de su comprensión sobre esto.
The community of inquiry that Matt Lipman and Anne Sharp developed in Philosophy for Children has a number of different sources. One of them is American Pragmatism, the School of Philosophy. In particular, the philosophers Charles Peirce and John Dewey wrote about inquiry in all areas as something that a community has to do. Like, you can't do good inquiry in science or in philosophy or in history without doing it as a community. A community can check each other's mistakes and build on each other's ideas. So that was one source. Another source is Soviet psychology. And Matthew Lipman was one of the first people to apply Soviet psychology in education. So particularly the psychology of Vygotsky, who wrote about the kind of learning that happens in a community, that you learn more by participating in a community of thinkers, in a community of language, than you do just working on your own. And then, of course, Socratic, the tradition of Socratic dialogue and the Socratic method of facilitating a Socratic dialogue is another important source.
Muy bien, en relación a estas perspectivas de esta comunidad, no sé si usted de hecho prefiere llamarla comunidad de diálogo o comunidad de indagación o comunidad de investigación, o a usted le da igual cualquiera de las tres referencias.
Yeah, in English, research and inquiry are almost the same thing. So we don't really distinguish those two. So I personally prefer inquiry, the community of inquiry. And the reason is that my own understanding of philosophical inquiry is that dialogue is one of the primary methods, but it's not the whole method. So in other words, we may begin with a question and we discuss it in dialogue and we explore it and we explore many possible answers to the questions and we go in many different directions. But in the end, we try to narrow down on what we think is the most reasonable or the most satisfying answer to the question. But in the pragmatist tradition, which I favor, we don't really know that the answer is satisfactory until we try to live with it. We put the answer we formed in dialogue into a lived experience of experimentation. We have to experiment in life with the ideas that we came up with in dialogue. And when we do that, more problems will arise, more questions will arise that we have to keep inquiring about.
Muy bien. Hace un momento hablábamos sobre cómo hay dos líneas, dos maneras para desplegar esta investigación filosófica. La comunidad, la misma comunidad de diálogo e investigación, pero también hablábamos del currículo, los materiales, las novelas. Yo quisiera, Mon, usted que además ha sido uno de los sucesores de Matthew Lidman, y como sucesor, supongo, hay un cierto acercamiento a ese currículo, a esa propuesta de novelas. ¿Qué tan importante es para hacer filosofía para niños estas novelas? Y lo pregunto porque hoy hay muchas otras prácticas con otros materiales. Sigue siendo vital, fundamental, el manejo del currículo tradicional de Matthew Lidman y Anne-Margaret Char.
It depends on why you are doing philosophy with children, I think. It depends on how you understand what it means to do philosophy with children and why you would do that. So I think it's a very important question. Let me say this. In broad terms, I don't think I would say they're necessary. I think they're very helpful for certain kinds of purposes. And I think maybe by analogy, we might think about other kinds of things like music or art, where we think children have a natural ability or a natural inclination. So what's the purpose of teaching children a particular method or a particular discipline of art or of music or of anything else, of literacy? Matthew Lidman believed that children have a natural inclination to do philosophy, but there are a number of philosophical skills or inquiry skills that help them to do it better. So part of the reason he wrote his novels and the manuals that go along with the novels are to emphasize these inquiry skills and give children the opportunity to practice certain very particular inquiry skills. Just like you might practice the piano, or you might practice a certain kind of brush stroke if you're doing a certain kind of painting, to help you develop your talent and make the most of your talent. I really think Matthew Lidman thought that children were philosophically talented, but in order to build those talents, they needed these kinds of skills. The other aspect of that is that he deliberately wrote into his novels ideas from the history of Western philosophy. And he and Anne Sharp both believed that the tradition of questions and different positions from the history of Western philosophy was an important heritage to give to children. And he also thought that, and Gareth Matthews also agreed with this, that it was a centuries-long conversation that we were welcoming children into so that they can become part of that conversation, both so that the conversation of Western philosophy can help children think through the problems of their own lives as a resource, and also so that children can challenge and change and build on and do something new with that tradition. Philosophy, then you would use some of their materials. Can I say, I want to add one more bit to that? All three of those founders, Matthews and Lidman and Sharp, have been criticized for limiting the materials they developed and the children's stories that they used to the Western philosophical tradition, which is mostly white and predominantly male. And I just want to say that all three of them recognized that as a limitation. And they knew that they were not capable. For example, the Lippmann Sharpe materials don't include Latin American philosophy, and they don't include African philosophy, and they only make a few very subtle references to Asian philosophy. But they knew that they were not equipped to work within all of those traditions. And so what they hoped was that other people around the world would get involved in the Philosophy for Children project, and that they would write their own materials to help children in different places learn how to become part of the philosophical conversation of their own traditions in their own parts of the world. I personally agree with that approach, because I personally think it's important to help. I think it's part of education to help children inherit their traditions in a way that, on the one hand, can give meaning to their lives, but on the other hand, give them an opportunity to reconstruct those traditions. So it's not that we want to impose our traditions, our cultural traditions, on the new generation of children in a way that forces them into something that they have no choice about. When we educate children into our tradition, it's because we believe that this tradition will still give their life meaning, that our traditions of cooking and of religion and of philosophy and of history and of literature and of music, etc., are part of what make our lives beautiful and worth living. And we believe that they will do the same for our children. But of course, we understand that the children will have to reconstruct those traditions, because they will face new problems and new opportunities that we did not face. So we also want to equip them to question the traditions, to challenge the traditions, and to change and reconstruct our traditions. So if you believe that philosophy is part of that, that it's important to help children in whatever tradition you are to inherit their philosophical tradition, then you would want to use materials like Lippmann and Sharpe developed, or the kinds of storybooks that Matthews used that introduce children to that tradition.
Mon, a propósito de esa reconstrucción, de ese más allá de toda esa tradición que para nosotros constituye un tesoro, Matthew Lippmann and Margaret Sharpe, ¿qué propuestas e iniciativas conoce usted que sigan fieles como a ese espíritu filosófico, que mantengan ese espíritu filosófico también en la literatura o con otras formas de lenguajes? ¿Qué conoce usted de experiencias y trabajos o currículos relacionados con esta propuesta de filosofía para niños?
Well, the first one that comes to my mind is Hawaii, where I first learned philosophy for children. I think Tom Jackson has done a brilliant job of reconstructing the Lippmann Sharpe approach to what they call P4C Hawaii, where they've taken some traditional concepts and practices of the Hawaiian tradition, and by Hawaiian I mean the Hawaiian Pacific Asian traditions, to inform how they do philosophy with children there. And they've, it's both in terms of some of the protocols that they use, how they define what it means to be an intellectually safe community, and it's also some of the materials that they've developed. I know a number of people around the world who have who began studying with Lippmann and Sharpe, but then went off and did things quite different, developed new materials, new curriculum materials. I know, for example, Daniela Kamhi in Austria has done amazing work with refugees, prisons, and very different kinds of community groups, in bringing different groups of people and children together to do philosophy. And she's, in each case, she's had to create new materials, new novels and new stories, and finding picture books and children's literature that were appropriate to those projects.
Muy bien, en este marco de personas que ya empezamos a nombrar, personas que vienen haciendo propuestas de currículos, adaptaciones, gracias por el dato de Daniela y a Tom Jackson, que a propósito ojalá los podamos tener aquí en el puente próximamente, así que oyentes, estén pendientes porque podríamos tenerlos. Pero Mon, quisiera que además de esta línea en la que nos hemos ido acercando a los currículos, a la propuesta de Lippmann, hablemos de la vía que ha tomado la investigación en el mundo de la filosofía para niños. Usted ha coordinado ahora este trabajo de la investigación. ¿Cómo se está investigando en esta propuesta de filosofía para niños? ¿Hay unos temas de los cuales se está investigando? ¿Quiénes están haciendo esta investigación? Hablemos un poco de ese tema.
Well, I'm very excited that the field of research in philosophy for children is becoming stronger and stronger. I think that it was strong in the very beginning, but educational research, I think, has grown in the last 50 years so tremendously, and the methods of conducting rigorous empirical research in education have really flowered and flourished over the past several decades, and philosophy for children is benefiting from that. So, for example, our colleague Joe Euler, who is now in Ireland, has done some amazing research on what kinds of moves by a facilitator in a community of inquiry result in the deepest kind of thinking and participation by the children. And that's something that had not been studied before. And he developed actually some new ways of collecting evidence around that question, which is very exciting. My colleague Alina Reznitskaya at Montclair State has done amazing work with her area is dialogic teaching. And she's used philosophy for children as one of the most successful models of dialogic teaching in order to study what that means and how what it means for a teacher to teach in a dialogic manner and what the effects are on the way that children think and talk. So empirically, there's a lot of exciting stuff going on, but there's also philosophical research going on, which I think is equally exciting. One of the projects that came out of this book on Gareth Matthews was to look closer at what happens in children's literature when Matthew says that children's literature, some children's literature at least, can go philosophical, can invite philosophical thinking in children. What does that mean? How does it do that? What is it about certain kinds of children's stories that leads children into certain kinds of philosophical questions? That's something that Megan and I and a number of other people are looking at. So those are just a few examples. But I think it's very exciting. And I just want to mention here that we were successful in getting Philosophy for Children included in the field papers, philosophypapers.org project, which is it's an index of all publications in every branch of philosophy in every language. And just a couple of years ago, we got them to agree to include publications in philosophy for children in that index. And so that's making it a lot easier for us to share our research with each other in the philosophy for children community.
A propósito de esta inclusión, Mon, estaba explorando un poco en la página de Philopapers. Quisiera saber cómo estamos clasificados, digamos, en filosofía para niños, porque hay diferentes categorías, hay metafísica, hay epistemología, teoría tal vez en la línea lógica. Filosofía para niños, ¿cómo está clasificado? Y además esto también es una pregunta que le asalta a muchas personas. ¿Filosofía para niños está enmarcado dentro de una didáctica de la filosofía, enseñanza de la filosofía, o también puede estar conectada en los otros campos? En particular, ¿cómo están Philopapers? Pero también, ¿Cómo podríamos ayudar a que las personas entendieran que filosofía para niños no solo está en didáctica, supongo? ¿Qué piensa usted?
Well, I think, first of all, one of the exciting developments in philosophy for children research over the past maybe 10 or 20 years is that it's becoming very interdisciplinary. So people in philosophy for children are using methods of research from other disciplines like history, anthropology, psychology, education, childhood studies, to ask different kinds of questions about philosophy for children and to use different methods of research to answer those questions. So first I'll say that. And then along with that has come something that I think is even more exciting, is that people in other disciplines are looking at philosophy for children as being relevant to their disciplines. For example, philosophy and history and education and childhood studies, just for an example, there's a new book out on childhood studies that spends a lot of time talking about philosophy for children and how important it is for people studying childhood studies to take a look at what's going on in philosophy for children. And then to answer your question about Phil Papers, we had to negotiate with the directors of Phil Papers for the subcategories of research in philosophy for children that would be included in the index, because they already had a very complex system or taxonomy of philosophy subjects, and we had to fit into that. So I've just called up the webpage, and I can just tell you what they are. They are Philosophy for Children Aesthetics, the Community of Inquiry in Philosophy for Children, Educational Theory and Methods, Ethics, Metaphilosophy, Religion and Spirituality, Political Philosophy, Reasoning, Specific Philosophers, and Introductions to Philosophy for Children, Philosophy in Schools, and Philosophy of Childhood.
Fantástico. Justamente aquí la estamos viendo el desarrollo de la página. Yo creo que esto es una información bastante importante para todas las personas que están investigando en este momento, haciendo trabajos de grado, tesis. Hay muchas personas que, de hecho, en Colombia y en el mundo vienen haciendo muchas investigaciones. Aquí está Philo Papers, y así como lo está diciendo Mon, aquí está la clasificación. Y es bastante interesante cómo uno puede ingresar a algunas de ellas. Y hay además una descripción de este tópico, y empieza después la clasificación de algunos artículos en relación con esta área. Así que yo creo que es bastante interesante.
So I encourage anyone working in philosophy for children who has a publication to put it into Phil Papers so that it can be shared.
Bueno, pues ahí tenemos entonces un camino de lo que se está haciendo en investigación, lo que se viene trabajando y las formas como además están compartiendo sus trabajos de investigación. Philo Papers es uno, pero también asimismo existen revistas especializadas, de alguna forma las enunciaba hace un momento Mon, pero vale la pena que le hagamos la pregunta. Las revistas, Mon, y los espacios a nivel de congresos, ¿cómo se están socializando estas investigaciones?
Well, I'm not sure I even know of them all. They're growing so quickly, which is a very exciting thing. Of course, the ICPIC journal is one of the most important. It's called Childhood and Philosophy. It's the journal of the ICPIC Association. There's also a journal called Philosophy in Schools, which is published in Australia. There's also a journal called Analytic Teaching and Philosophical Praxis, which is published in Wisconsin in the United States. And there's also a journal called Questions, and that is published by the Plato Organization, which is located in Washington State in the United States. Plato stands for Philosophy Learning and Teaching Association. It's a Philosophy for Children network. Those are the main journals that I'm aware of. Conferences is also very exciting. Of course, as Victor mentioned, the global conference, the international conference, is ICPIC, and that's every other year. The next one will be a year from now in 2022 in Tokyo. We're very excited about that, in August.
Nice.
And then there are regional conferences in philosophy for children. So there's a conference by the North American Association, which is Canada, the United States, and Mexico. They do a conference every other year. There's a conference in the Asian Pacific region. There's a regional organization of Asia and the Pacific that holds a conference, a regular conference. Daniela in Austria holds a conference every year. And then there are local conferences all over the place, and I sometimes don't even know about them, but it's very exciting. I have to say that I've been working in philosophy for children for almost 30 years now, and I think maybe the best philosophy for children conference I ever attended was in Bogota, when Uniminuto hosted the ICPIC conference a few years ago. It was an amazing conference. And I'm not just saying that. I'm totally serious in terms of the ideas that were there. The presentations were outstanding. And of course, Victor and his team, just that we were so beautifully welcomed and everything ran so smoothly. It was an incredible conference.
Bueno, y aquí está, ya preparándonos entonces, vamos a compartir pantalla, porque usted acaba de mencionar que vamos para el 2022, nos vamos para Tokio, y aquí está el EPIC 2022, una conferencia en la cual estaremos pensando sobre las diferentes enfoques, desarrollos sociales, culturales, políticos, así que a través de un desarrollo y el crecimiento de del pensamiento filosófico. Hablemos, por favor, Mon Gregory, ¿de qué forma vamos a poder participar en Tokio 2022 y cuál es ese foco temático sobre el cual girará este evento?
Well, the theme of the conference, I think as Victor mentioned, is philosophy for children or with children across cultural, social, and political differences, which I think is a very exciting theme, and I think it's very timely all over the world. It's very interesting to me how philosophy for children is used by people with very different agendas, educational agendas. Some of those agendas are more politically to the right, and many of those agendas are more politically to the left. So I think there's really important discussion and dialogue that we need to have about this. Not that we all have to agree on what philosophy for children means, but I really believe that the way we do philosophy for children has to do with the assumptions we make or deep beliefs we hold about childhood and about education and about philosophy. So there are some very important philosophically controversial ideas that we need to talk about, that we need to discuss and learn from each other, even if it's just to understand the differences that we have between us. And the deadline for submissions for the conference is coming up at September 15th. So it's only 3.5 months away to prepare a proposal. So I think the best way to get involved is to look over the website that the Tokyo Committee have made. The Tokyo Committee has worked very hard. Like Victor says, it takes a few years to organize something like this. And the Tokyo Committee has done really good work. And they've made a wonderful website that's in Japanese and English. So I encourage everyone to look over the website and think about how you might participate and prepare something by September 15th.
Bueno, pues estamos preparadísimos, ya además entusiasmados para participar. Mon, y ya sabemos si este evento, si esta conferencia va a ser virtual, presencial, que no sé si está muy pronto para saberlo, pero ¿qué han pensado?
It's going to be a mostly in-person conference, but there will be some online sessions.
Bueno, pues estaremos entonces preparándonos. Seguramente aquí en el puente tendremos pronto a las personas de Tokio hablándonos sobre el evento y también motivando la participación, pero todos ustedes que nos siguen y que están siempre pendientes del puente, pues aquí estaremos dándoles información sobre cómo participar del EPIC 2022 en Tokio. Aquí estamos hablando de investigación, hoy con Mon Gregory, una persona que tiene una trayectoria muy importante en el mundo de filosofía para niños y que hoy ha querido aceptar esta invitación a participar en esta entrevista. Mon, hay una expresión que se utiliza incluso en la publicidad del Congreso y que ha ido incursionando mucho, y es filosofía para con niños. ¿Qué piensa usted? Ese para, por, sin, ¿qué podríamos decir sobre estas preposiciones?
I think it's a lot of noise. I think that what Gareth Matthews and Matthew Littman and Anne Margaret Sharp first developed was clearly doing philosophy with children, but they all called it philosophy for children, and then years later people thought, well, maybe philosophy with children is a better description of what we do, which I agree. But I think that sometimes it's been politicized or in an opportunistic way that I don't like at all. Because when you look at what people do who call themselves philosophy with children and what people do who call themselves philosophy for children, I don't think you could tell a difference. So I think that I don't think it matters what you call it. I mean, it might matter if you have a certain reason and you're very explicit about that. But if all you're doing is saying, oh, I'm doing something different, so I'm calling it something different, in my experience, there's really not a significant difference.
Muy bien, pues es la forma como filosofía para niños se está comprendiendo y la forma como se está investigando el más allá. Mon, hoy tenemos finalmente, estamos llegando al final de esta entrevista y quisiera finalmente hacer referencia a este reto que tenemos hoy en términos de la virtualidad y en términos de todos los conflictos sociales y políticos que se están viviendo, particularmente en Colombia. Atravesamos un momento fuerte a nivel de desarrollo social, a nivel de protesta social. Pero también el COVID nos ha encerrado y nos ha arrojado hacia la virtualidad y a comunicarnos de esta manera. Y eso nos reta, la situación actual nos reta. ¿Cómo podríamos identificar un par de retos que tiene filosofía para niños o filosofía para con niños, los que estamos trabajando en esto, en este momento histórico que atraviesa el mundo?
I love this question because it's something I think about all the time, and I think the challenges keep changing. When I was first beginning in philosophy for children, one of the biggest challenges was conservative groups, like conservative religious groups and conservative parent groups that did not want children to philosophize because they worried that children would begin to challenge their traditions, their political and religious traditions. But today, I don't think that's the major challenge. Do you want to translate that? I think right in, at least in my context, and I think in many parts of the world, the biggest challenge to philosophy for philosophy with children is neoliberalism. Because neoliberalism is forcing education to focus so narrowly on the economics of education, preparing children to become part of the market economy. And that becomes so important that all the other purposes of education, like political awakening, and spiritual deepening, and philosophical awakening, are often ignored. And unless you can prove that doing philosophy somehow raises children's test scores in a way that will make them more competitive in colleges and make the national economy more competitive, then people don't want to give you the time to do philosophy, and I think that's a tragedy. It's also the reason that so many colleges and high schools are losing programs in the humanities, including history and languages and philosophy, because they're just not seen as economically viable anymore.
Muy bien, pues ahí está Mon Gregory presentando sus retos y la forma como esta propuesta de filosofía para niños tiene una vigencia, qué forma hoy se está haciendo, cómo se está trabajando, en qué se está investigando y además los desafíos que tenemos en la actualidad. Pues Mon, de esta forma ya llegamos al final de este espacio, de este diálogo que hemos tenido con usted. De verdad, gracias por estar una vez más con nosotros aquí en Uniminuto, después del IPIC no lo veíamos, otra vez con nosotros. Recuerde que esta es su casa, aquí siempre bienvenido y gracias por este tiempo que nos ha regalado.
Thank you, Victor, and thank you, Jairo, for the translation. I'm always honored to be involved with Uniminuto, and I'm always delighted, particularly, to be in conversation with you, Victor.
Muy bien, oyentes y seguidores de nuestras redes sociales, gracias por haber estado con nosotros en este puente, hoy con un invitado especial, con, ya les decía al comienzo de esta entrevista, con un invitado de habla inglesa que ha estado con nosotros y que además tiene un gran aporte en el mundo de la filosofía para niños. Recuerden que tenemos una cita aquí en el puente, estamos dialogando, yo soy Víctor Rojas y gracias en la conducción, también en la parte técnica a mi amiga Evelyn. A todos ustedes, gracias por estar con nosotros. Recuerde que nos encontramos de lunes a viernes a las 11 de la mañana a través de los 14:30 AM o a través de las diferentes redes como es Marfil Educación Filosófica. Hasta luego.
Esta es Uniminuto Radio, HJKU, en Bogotá en los 14:30 AM y en Colombia y el mundo a través de uniminutoradio.com.co. También en Facebook, Twitter e Instagram a través de @UniminutoRadio. La radio universitaria está aquí.